Welcome, Pastor Mazino. It's been nice having you around, and welcome to Ignite Kingdom Living video cast. So I have one of the questions I've wanted to ask you. What will you say is the heart of God for the church in this season?
Well, first of all, what is the heart of God? I think the Apostle Paul has clearly told us what the heart of God is. In Colossians, he tells us that the mystery that has been hidden from ages and generations is Christ in us, the hope of glory. The glory of the church is that we are conformed to the image of Christ, that Christ be formed in us. It is the dream that God has had before the foundations of the earth. And when we disconnect from that vision, that agenda, that divine agenda, we lose the glory of God. We lose the glory of God. So we are now in a time where, as it were, there's a lot of disconnect. So relative to this time, I believe that the heart of God is a lamentation for God's people to come back to the heart of God. It's a lamentation because we don't see the glory of God as we should. So we are saying, let's be humble, come back to God and say, we've missed it somewhere, we've quenched your spirit, and so your reality is not as evident as it should be. So let's be humble. I believe that right now God will be raising a lot of prophets, a lot of apostles, a lot of pastors, whose duty is to bring the church back to the pursuit of Christ again, to the doctrine of Christ, so that we'll be changed into the image of Jesus Christ, and flee all this emptiness and materialism and vanities and things that lead us into worldliness and being subsumed in the, vain cultures of the world.
Okay. Now, what would be the advice you would give to an upcoming minister, someone who is just coming up and wants to be really involved in the work of the Lord?
Well, I mean, to start with, I would say that you must first and foremost understand who a minister is in these last times. A minister of the gospel, the Bible is very clear about who a minister is in Ephesians and chapter 4. It tells us he gave apostles, pastors, teachers, prophets, and evangelists to do the work of the ministry. And the bottom line in verse 15, he says, to bring us to the place where we will come to the full stature of Jesus Christ. So I would say very first and foremost is the message. And that's one of the things the Apostle Paul warned Timothy about in, I think it's 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 16. He says, take heed to your message. If not, you're going to destroy people with the wrong message, or you're going to build people, and you will destroy your own soul. So you have to know what's the message I've received from God. This is first and foremost, because people just coming and they will just preach anything and they say anything. So the message is very crucial. Make sure you spend time hearing from God, and the message is clear. It's the same thing. We have to bring people to Christ.
In a nation like Nigeria, we've had the message of the gospel. We had in the late 90s, in the early 90s and late 80s, seemed not to be the same message of the gospel we have today. Well, what do you think is the cause for it?
And what kind of message are you talking about in the 90s? I mean, depends on what you mean.
Yeah. The message of the gospel, mm-hmm. that's Christianity, mm-hmm. in its totality as presented to the people.
To be honest with you, I don't know that we've ever really had the message of the gospel, the true message of the gospel. I don't know that. I mean, few and far between. You have little oases here and there of people who had, you know, entered into the gospel. But by and large, I mean, what we've seen is a lot of what they thought was fate or faith and prosperity, and you know, and you can see where this has led to. It has led to self-centeredness. So we have now what I call a religion of self-seeking. Yeah, it's led to a lot of materialism and so on. So this is not the gospel. The gospel is the doctrine of Christ. It's the gospel of Christ. And it brings us to the image of Christ, the holy image of Christ. It brings us to true love. It brings us to carry a cross. It brings us to intimacy with the Holy Spirit. It prepares us as a bride, a holy bride, a pure bride for Jesus Christ. I do not know that I can recollect where that message has really been preached. So, I mean, by and large, the predominantly popular and large ministries, I don't think this has been their focus. And so that's my concern. That why I say I don't really know that the gospel, the pure gospel of conformity to the image of Christ has been, you know, really preached in Nigeria.
So there's this idea that if a ministry does not have thousands of people in the ministry, they are probably not doing well with God, and the ones who have thousands of people are doing well with God. What do you say to that?
Well, I mean, God is not about numbers. I mean, if we're about numbers, most of the prophets and Jesus Christ himself would be a failure. I mean, Jesus left with about 120 disciples on the earth by the time he was leaving. John the Baptist, I mean, had just a handful of them, really. You know, it's not about numbers, and it's not about numbers. It's okay to have numbers. Like I said, what is important is what is the fruit of what you're producing? Is the fruit of what you're producing the fruit of Christ? Is that what it is? If that's what it is, and God chooses to, you know, bring people to it, all well and good. So I have no problem with, you know, people having people. But if there's not a lot of people, I mean, I for one, we don't have a very big church. You understand? And I don't consider this. The way God sees things is different from the way man sees things. You see, man looks at the outward, but God looks at things very differently. The Bible says in Luke chapter 15 and 16, verse 15, it says that what is highly esteemed with man is an abomination to God. Luke chapter 1, verse 15, the Bible says that John the Baptist, that he was great in the sight of God. But John the Baptist, by all earthly standards, is a failure. You know, so I mean, what really matters, the church in Sardis, for example, in Revelation chapter 3 from verse 1 to 6, the Bible says they had a testimony that they were alive in the eyes of man. They had a reputation that, wow, these guys are doing very well. But the Bible says in the eyes of God, they were dead. The church in Laodicea, the Bible says that you guys say that you're rich, you're increased in goods, you have all of these earthly things that, you know, everybody has. But guess what? The Bible says you're blind, you're wretched, you're poor. How can you tell a church that is rich, they probably have all these cathedrals and they're making so much money, and all men see that they have money. But in heaven, in God's eyes, they are poor. Yeah. So we have to be sure that the prism or the lenses that we look at things are God's lenses, because God doesn't look the way man looks. And that's why I'm saying the criteria in God's eyes are things like our hearts, are things like our message, are things like intimacy with the Holy Ghost. Are we really intimate with the Holy Ghost, you know, and so on and so forth.
Wow, amen. Now, from my observation, I've actually noticed that most churches that preach this message, talk about a conformity to the image of Christ. Both at home and here, they don't have big congregations. Most of them don't have up to 100 congregations on a Sunday morning. You know, I mean, it's what I've observed.
I agree and partially with that. Yes, many don't. I think most, I think I would say I agree because you said most, not all. I mean, there are churches, I mean, even in America, I know, I mean, a few churches, you know, there's Times Square Church where David Wilkerson preached, and you have Katakono now, it's a big church. There's still, you know, God always reserves people for himself. And so there are people, and some of them, they have a big size. There's nothing wrong with a big size. I want us to be clear on that. But the truth of the matter is, because of the prevailing culture, this message is now, like an aberration to the prevailing culture. And so it's resisted, because this message brings you to a place where you cannot be a part of the world system. I'm talking about the culture of the world. God places that demand where you have to come out from amongst them. And they don't want to, because now with television, with entertainment as it, we know it now, it's a different ball game. It lures them. Everything is. Look, I mean, we are in an age of pornography. I mean, 30, 20, 40 years ago, 30 years, when I was a young boy, I mean, there was nothing like that. We didn't hear stuff like that. Now it's all over the place. When I was in the high school or in the college, I remember then I schooled in the UK, and if you see a magazine, pornographic magazine, it used to be in the tube stations, and they would hide them before you can buy it. If you even tried to, you wouldn't get it. Now, at the click of a button. So there's so much that is tugging against the hearts of people in this generation that it will take a very strong gospel to reinforce the culture of Christ in our hearts. And it's predominantly absent. So you find out that, you know, people now look at, you know, the message of Christ as, you know, this is too far-fetched, this is too, because, you know, it's not being really preached and people are, you know, resisting it.
Is it normal for a Christian, a true Christian, that is a follower of Jesus Christ, to listen to this message and be very uncomfortable? Because some people seems to be very uncomfortable with this kind of message. They feel it's too harsh. What do you say to that?
I think Jesus has already answered that. He says, when he talked about, for God so loved the world, gave his only begotten Son, whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. He said, because God has sent his light to the world, but because men love darkness rather than light, so they run away from the light. It's just what it is. The truth of the matter is that if your heart is dark, you will run away from light. And if your heart has light, you will want light. So Jesus said, he says, because men want to continue with their wicked deeds and their evil ways. I mean, if you tell a fornicator, an adulterer, or a liar, or a cheat, or somebody, look at Jesus. It's not just now. Jesus spoke to a rich man. The guy was probably making money by falsehood or God knows what. And then he tells him, look, you know what? Sell everything you have. And I've had a few people I've had to tell that. You know, you've made money through fraud. You've made money through crime and so on and so forth. And you tell them, sell everything. And you will find out the power of money in the hearts of men versus the power of doing right by God. So they're not going to want to do that. It will take a heart that is truly like Zacchaeus, who was a criminal, really, a tax collector that was duping people. And he said, God, I'm going to give 4 times everything I've stolen back. And he did a kind of restitution, as it were. So the truth of the matter is that when people's hearts are really broken, they come to God. When people are truly looking for light, they will come to God. But when they are not, then they would resist the message. If not, I do believe in my heart, like Jesus said in John chapter 7, says that if you're really looking for God, you will come to me. Because the message I bring will only bring you deeper in God. But the truth is that the message exposes the heart. It tells you what is really in your heart. And like the rich man, when Jesus said, okay, sell all, the Bible says, he looked at Jesus and said, I'm sorry, I cannot. And even though he came and said, I want eternal life. But you'll find out that sometimes to be right with God, the direction he's going to ask you to come in, your heart is not ready to go that way because there are other things that are holding your heart that you're not ready to give up. You know, so.
That's beautiful. And there's this idea that we don't need to press into God. You just have to relax and, you know, just relax and then the Spirit will come. What do you say to that, you know, just relax. There's no pressing into God. There's no striving into God. And it's begin to gradually grow in the charismatic circle here in the U.S. What do you say to that?
Well, I mean, that's clear falsehood. I mean, the whole New Testament, I won't even talk about the Old Testament, the New Testament. I mean, I've heard a lot of things when people talk about works. We're not saved by works, but we're saved unto good works. And listen, if I have a book out I wrote on the true gospel of grace, and I had read some places where they said, you know, God doesn't want any performance, he doesn't want works, and blah, 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 blah. It's not true. The Bible says, lay aside. Lay aside is works. Lay aside means lay aside. The Bible says, flee. This is New Testament. Flee. Flee all appearances of evil. This is what, we have to do this. He says, put your body under so that you don't be a castaway. Discipline yourself. These are things we have to do by the grace of God. We have to seek the enablement of the Holy Spirit to do these things. The Bible says, abhor. The Bible says, resist. These are actions we have to take. And this is how to press into God. Walk in the Spirit. You will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Sow to the Spirit. With Galatians, for example, Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, 8, and 9, it tells you, it says that if you sow to the Spirit, what does it mean, sow to the Spirit? That means if you invest in the Spirit. 1 Peter chapter 1, for example, 2 Peter chapter 1, from verse 5 downwards, it tells you, it says, now add to your faith diligence, add to your faith virtue, add to your faith kindness. There's additions, there's things we have to do. So anybody saying we don't have to do anything is deceiving yourself. The Bible says we should fast. The Bible says we should pray. The Bible says that we should not, do certain things, and we should do certain things. In fact, I have a teaching out I called 1,050 commandments. Do you know, in the New Testament, there are 1,050 commandments. 1,050.
I was thinking there is only one commandment in the New Testament.
No,
or
I know.
Two at most. Love the Lord thy God with
and
all thy heart and
good.
Love
so,
yourself.
Of course, there are two commandments. But in those two commandments, God has given us instructions on how to manifest the Christ life. If you look at there's one. I'm writing a little book now. I call Build Your House on the Rock. And that is a message I really want to pass across to people, telling people that, hey, look, Jesus taught in Matthew chapter 7. He said, anyone who wants to get real security and guarantee of God's, support and God's presence, he says, he must build his house on the rock of obedience. He says that, so is he who hears my word and does my word. He shall be like a man who built his house on the rock. Because the hearer who is not a doer, the Bible says he's wasting his time. That such a person cannot be blessed. So, when you read the scriptures, I'm writing now, I'm just, the first portion of the book, I'm taking little portions of instructions, is Romans and chapter 12. I challenge you to read Romans 12. And I'm only going to, I call this one 21 in 13. In the 13 verses from verse 9 to verse 21, you have 13 verses there. You have 21 instructions. Go read it up. It's clear. Abhor evil. Flee this. It tells us in another place, do not condescend. It says, condescend to men of low estate. It's right. Go, just take your time and read that. Go to Ephesians chapter 5 from verse 1. In fact, the whole of Ephesians, when you start from verse 4, Ephesians chapter 1 to 3 is doctrinal. It teaches you what Christ has done. Then chapter 4 down to 6, verse almost verse by verse, it tells you what to do. If you're stealing, don't steal again. These are instructions. And what are the instructions? They're instructions in righteousness, as the Bible says. It says the word of God is for doctrine, and the word of God is for instruction in righteousness. What's an instruction in righteousness? A commandment. An instruction is the same thing as a commandment. It's just God telling you, this is what I want you to do. So the generality of the New Testament is full of instructions, because we have to understand how eternal life works, how the life of righteousness works. And so he's showing us, this is how righteousness operates, the righteousness of Christ. This is how Christ did what he did. He says, don't look at yourself more highly than you should. Don't look down at other people. There's so many instructions there. So I didn't do the study. The first person I read this study was in Phineas Jenkins Dakes. Have you ever heard a Dakes Bible? Well, Dakes Bible, for those who are older Christians, have been around when we didn't have internet and all of that. We survived by the Dakes Bible. Okay. No, he studied and came out with a study material, 42 years of study. And if you look at his footnotes towards the end, he did a study on all the instructions in the New Testament, and he came up with 1,050 of them. You'll be shocked how many be not, do not, do's. It's all there. So when you read it, you'll see that you have over 1,000 of them in the New Testament. I'm not talking of Old Testament. And those are not laws, but these are instructions on how righteousness is operated.
Hallelujah. Now, you shared something with me. I would like you to share in this interview. I think that was the first time we were outside at the hotel, about Jesus Christ being the holiness standard and the template. And that is God's ultimate dream for the Christian, for mankind. Can you share a little bit of that?
I mean, that's the heart of the gospel, like we're saying. I mean, a lot of people fail to understand who is Jesus Christ. And we think Jesus is just Savior. Jesus is Savior. That's the first part of his ministry. But that's not the end of his ministry. He's Savior to become a template. And that's what the writer of Hebrews is trying to teach when you get to Hebrews chapter 10. In fact, the whole of Hebrews is teaching that. But by chapter 10, he says, a body you have prepared for me. And he says, lo, I come in the volume of the book to do your will. So the way it is God's word was encapsulated in a man. When we say in the beginning was the word, that means in the beginning was the will of God. So God's will, what is holiness? How do I arrive at it? So God wanted to be merciful to mankind. And so he said, okay, I'm going to show man how to live holy, what holiness means to me. So in his wisdom, he put holiness in a man. He sent a man here. And that man did the will of God to the point that God was so pleased. And then God declared, this is my beloved son whom I am well pleased. Now hear him. That's where we get righteousness of Christ from. The righteousness of Christ simply means that Christ lived a life that pleased God. That righteousness is pleasing God. That's all. Righteousness means being in a right standing with God. And in the Old Testament, we have people who had little elements, little expressions of righteousness. You have an Abraham who believed God and it was counted to him. But there are other things he didn't do right. But Jesus came and fulfilled complete righteousness. He did right by God, and God had to make a public declaration from heaven. And he said, this is my beloved son with whom I am well pleased. Now, listen to him. That's why we now have Jesus as a template. He was tempted as we are. That's what the Bible says, in every way. But he didn't sin. That means that no matter whatever temptation you and I will go through, if we look at the life of Jesus, the 33 years he lived here, we can find how to please God by doing it exactly how Jesus did it. That's the meaning of the will of God. So the will of God now, if you, I mean, we have a Bible, but I'm going to make a statement. If we never had a Bible and all we did was we had a movie that just showed us every thought and every action and every word of Jesus Christ, we already have a Bible. The life that Jesus lived for 33 years is a Bible. It is the complete will of God. Every thought, every action. He was tempted in every area. So we can now look to Christ, and that's the meaning of follow me. When Jesus says, follow me, he's saying, learn me, emulate me. You see what I'm saying? Follow me. So that's what it means in Hebrews chapter 12. He says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Jesus is everything. He's done the will of God. He never sinned once. God is pleased with him. He's the righteousness. So now Paul says that, now I count everything but dung. I no longer want the righteousness that is by the law. I don't want any other kind of righteousness. The only righteousness I want is the righteousness that Christ manifested. That's what it means to be the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. It means now we have accepted that God sent Jesus, and God attested that Jesus lived right by God. And now, as it were, we have been matriculated. When you become born again, you're matriculated into the righteousness of God. It doesn't end there. Now you have to learn Christ. Learn of me. I am meek. I'm lowly. So we learn Christ, and then we bear the fruit of righteousness. We grow in the fruit of righteousness. That's the meaning of that. So Jesus becomes the embodiment of the will of God, the express image of the holiness of God. And so when we learn in Christ, we're actually learning true holiness. And that's different from people who just go to the Old Testament or somewhere and they bring you one rule, do not wear head scarf. Or this is not what it's about. I mean, when I hear people say that, that's false holiness. False holiness will tell you, you cannot wear this, you cannot do this. Do you realize that Jesus wore gowns? So is he also insane? This is not what matters. What matters is the heart. Our heart being pure and right like the heart of Jesus Christ. And that's what the Holy Spirit came to do for us. You see, if we understand the ministry of Christ, all of those things will be irrelevant. I went for a program with some students in one of these colleges, and we had about 2,000 of them. And I had a young lady who came to meet me, and she has all her hair covered, and she tells me that First Corinthians, she tells me God says cover her hair. She's talking about First Corinthians 11. I listened to a dear man of God. I love him. He's in the United Kingdom. His name is David Pawson, and he taught about this years ago, and it blessed me so much, and God used him to bless me. And he was talking about the shadow and the substance. You know, we need to be very careful what we consider to be the shadow or the substance and what we see as the shadow. If we pursue shadows and miss the substance, we will end up as Pharisees. So you have this young lady, she covers her hair, and she heard me say some things, and she came up to meet me. I took questions after the meeting, and she said to me, you know, Pastor, I cover my hair, that's what God is looking for, this is holiness, that the Bible says this, the Bible says that. So I asked her two questions. I said, number one, why do you cover your hair? The scripture says so. Do you know why the scripture says so in 1 Corinthians 11? It says because this sign of covering your hair shows that you are submitted to a man. That's the meaning of that. It was a sign in those days, in that culture, that you are submitted to a man. What is the point of covering your hair and you are fighting every day with your husband? So you have people today, it doesn't matter how their home is, they have quarrels, they have all kinds of bickering going on, all kinds of evil going on, but they cover their hair and they feel they're holy. They are deceiving themselves. You see, in Christ, it's just like modesty. I have an issue with ministers and Christians who are immodest because the Bible says, let your moderation be known to all men. So it's the same thing. It's no different, because I know people talk about women who are immodest in their dressing. There are men who are immodest in the way they live. You see them with all kinds of manners of things that it doesn't show any level of sobriety. It doesn't show any level of simplicity or modesty. In Christ, we learn simplicity. We learn modesty. And so it can fall on either side. Anybody should understand that it is the heart, is the heart. God wants a modest heart. And that's one of the things, the conversions. You see, the Lord is my shepherd. He leads me beside still water. And then he restores my soul. So the word of the Lord converts the soul. It restores the soul. The soul is being messed up by the devil and by the world system. And the word of God comes into us to change us, to give us a new way of thinking. The Bible says, be renewed in the spirit of your mind, in Ephesians chapter 4. So it kind of colonizes our mind, as it were, and gives us a different kind of thinking. Now I think in humility terms. Now I think in meekness terms. Now I think in modesty terms. So whether I'm a man or a woman, it behoves on me to learn Christ and be modest. As a woman, you shouldn't go out dressed in an improper way that is going to be seductive. As a man, you shouldn't do the same. We shouldn't do anything that is not modest. So, I mean, it's the heart. So we need to be careful, because these things are also, there's some level of relativity in these things too. Because what you think is modest here may not be modest there. This is the truth. It all depends. And I always tell people, depending on your environment. Because look here, I mean, if you come to here in the United States, I go around to the churches here, and you will find the average church is a campus. This is this huge 5,000, 10,000 seats auditorium. But if you bring that to Nigeria with the suffering and the poverty, and you go and build a structure that is 3, 5, 10 billion naira, and people cannot even eat, you understand? Then you have your priorities misplaced. You're not modest there. Because we don't need that. Do you understand what I'm saying? What we need is people. You can't invest on stones and mortar and brick, and then the real human beings are dying, and then you do that. It's a misplaced priority. But in a society like this, in many of the European societies, there's a lot of money. There's a lot of wealth they have. It's not a big deal for them to have that here. So I think that's why the scripture says, let your moderation be known to all men. And that's why I say it's relative. It is relative to your community. It's relative to your community. Here, I mean, come on. If you go to Russia, I had some guy almost attack me and tell me, no, women should never wear pants. They should not wear trousers. And I said, go and try that in Russia where the snow is there and tell me that women should not wear pants. You will freeze to death. They have to wear some kind of thing under there. And then there are some skirts that are even more provocative than all these things. That's not what God is looking for. He's looking at the heart. Just be right in your heart. He's looking for a pure heart, a heart that wants to do right by him.
Sufficient light has been thrown on this subject now, so we'll move on. I guess this will be the last question, okay. or maybe not question, but what I'll ask you to talk on, and that is how is holiness the ultimate dream of God?
How is holiness
the ultimate dream of God?
Well, I mean, first of all, because God is holy, and he chose that as his dream. That's what he wants. When he made man, if you ask me, why did the maker of this speaker make this speaker? He made this speaker for a purpose in his mind. And the purpose for which God made man did not just fall from the skies. And all this evolution is all a lie, because you know, even from science, the Latins have a popular adage they call ex nihilo nihil fit, something like that. It says, out of nothing comes nothing. Zero plus zero equals zero. Zero times zero equals zero. Zero divided by zero equals zero. So nothing cannot make something. Okay? So the fact that we see something here means that there has to be something that is supernatural, that is, that in fact, the meaning of God is the sovereign being, the being that is beyond our comprehension, that has to be responsible for making something. Because nothing, you see, man comes from an atom or from a bang or whatever. What brought the bang? Nothing cannot make something, okay? So the fact that there is something means, and it's not just something. Imagine if I told you today that, you know, the Boeing, I flew in this lovely plane when I was coming here. It's an Airbus, and it has a double decker, and it's really cool. It has all these engines, and you know, picture that. What if I just told you that it just dropped out from the sky? With all that engineering, with all that architecture, with all that organization? No, even the human body is too complex. Have you studied just the heart? When you start to go into the heart, it's a world on its own. The ventricles, the atrium, it's not an accident. Nothing of man is an accident. It's intelligently designed by God. And so if God designed man, he had a purpose for man. And the Bible teaches us that that purpose is that he wanted man to share in his nature of holiness. That's the meaning. That's why man is here. In fact, that's the meaning of the church. That's why the church has a message to the world, that God made man for a purpose, to share in his image. And his image is a holy image. What is holiness? Holiness is the purest form of expressing life. That's all. God operates by the purest form. The love of God is pure. The peace of God is pure. The joy of God is pure. God, everything about him is expressed in the purest form. That's why God is love. That's why, you know, God is kind. That's why God is compassionate. That's why God is just, you know. So God wanted man to live that way. That's his dream. That's his dream. Of course, it's been abused. And that's what Christ has come to restore. And God is saying that, okay, if you don't understand what my holiness, the image, my image is, I'll send a man to live like you, and he will live long enough, about 33 years, and he will show you what I'm talking about. And that's why Jesus is a template. And that's why I still believe that Christ, the solution to mankind, is not communism, it's not socialism, it's not capitalism, it's not democracy, it's not. The solution of mankind is Christism. If we can truly buy into this dream of God, and we can buy into this holiness of God, then you won't find man killing man. Let me tell you, the other day, I had a gentleman. I went to Liberia for a program, a conference like this. We sometimes organize conferences in different places. And we organized this conference in Liberia. And one of the people who came in, you just only need to go and Google him. His name was General Butt Naked. He's been interviewed by CNN, by BBC, by everybody. Steven Spielberg has flown to Liberia just to see him. He was one of the warlords in Liberia. He has confessed to killing over 20,000 people. He was a cannibal. He eats people up. He uses people as human sacrifices over the years. But God touched him. God touched him. And miracle, God changed him. And you need to see what God has made of this young man. I know him personally. He's visited me in Lagos a few times. I've housed him. He stayed in my home. I can attest to the fact that this is a man that has been changed. He is the meekest. There are times that people want to kill him because he killed their parents, he killed their brother. And he will bring himself and say, I can't bring them back to you. It was in my time of darkness. You can't tell me that Jesus will change the world. If the world can buy into the message of Christ, God will bring. If you meet this fellow now, who was the worst killer, who was the most, he doesn't, right now, if my wife says, hey, or I say, let's take him to a hotel, a restaurant to eat, he doesn't want to see meat. because he ate human flesh. And till today, he has a phobia for meat. Okay? He only eats fish. And that's just him. But if you meet this guy who was the most brutal human being, just that Jesus came into his life, turned him around. Jesus can change the world. If Christ comes into man's heart, I, speaking to you, when I was in the high school, in the university in Nigeria, I was in a secret confraternity. I was the head of a confraternity. I was rough. Fellow, I was not exactly, you know, a doll, a sweet little, I was a rough, violent person. And guess what? So I am talking firsthand. I was a womanizer. I used drugs. I did drugs and I smoked and I was stoned all the time. And just that I asked Jesus into my heart, it changed my whole world. And that's why you can see me here today. So, I think that even governments, we need to even speak to governments and let them know that there is something called Christism. By the power of the Holy Ghost, God can change mankind. God can make mankind walk in love. Now, I'm not moved by anything. When I hear people talk about racism, about terrorism, even terrorism cannot make me hate you. Racism, what all these isms they talk about? There's too much love in me. Christ has put love inside of me. He does that to people who walk with him. And if we can get people to see that, it's not about this religion of that. There's a reality from God that he's given us Christ, and Christ can change us. This is the meaning of holiness. Holiness is Christ. And when we receive Christ, we receive a superior life, what the Bible calls the perfect man. He makes us grow to the full stature of the perfect man, or the superior life, because holiness gives us a superior life. It makes you walk in such sacrificial love. Such sacrificial love. It makes you walk in such sacrificial, such awesome kindness. Because when we make Christ our yardstick, you can't help but love. Jesus says, he says, if you love people like others love, if you forgive only those who forgive you, he says, what does that mean? That's Luke chapter 6. He says, I want you to go the extra mile. If somebody slaps you on the face, turn the other cheek. Wow. If we follow Christ, we will be such beautiful specimens of beings on this earth. And that's the beauty. And that's the pain in my heart and in the heart of God, that a lot of people who call ourselves ministers, we've lost this vision. And we seem to be interested in the mundane things, and we've lost the real message and essence of God. His walk with man.
I know I said it was my last.
Don't worry, you're allowed.
I'm asking Don, he's there. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
All right, my last question now. This is the real last question.
All right, we believe you.
Now, can you just share let's say 1 minute or two, on the fear of the Lord? That's where we close today.
On the fear of the Lord. Yeah, I mean, like I said the other day, the fear of God is the foundation of wisdom. To be honest with you, I mean, even in the church, outside the church, one of the biggest challenges we have is to foster the fear of God in the hearts of people. Because there's nothing of God that you want to do if you don't have a strong foundation in the fear of God. You can't do it. You can't do it. You won't have the culture, like I said, is so rough out there. What makes me not, at the click of a button, I can become a pornographer? I can do any kind of thing nowadays. Everything is just there, right before you. What makes me not do it? The fear of God. If I don't have a healthy dose of the fear of God, I will do what I want to do. And that's why the fear of God is such a powerful regulator. And that's one of the first things. That's why God said, he said about Job and about Jesus, he said, you fear God, you hate evil, you love righteousness, because the fear of God is to hate evil. So one of the major things which has been lost in the church, like I said the other day, is that we are not, many people, many churches and many Christians are not being raised and fostered in the fear of God. If you remember, if you read the book of Ecclesiastes, after Solomon in all his wisdom and everything, what did he conclude that book with? He said, after everything, I have seen everything, and everything is vanity. It's all vanity. And he concludes the last few verses of Ecclesiastes chapter 12. He says, all is vanity upon vanities. He says, and my conclusion about life is fear God and keep his commandments. This is the truth. I believe that if we can be nurtured to really fear God, it will help us to really live this life of Christ. Because no matter how much you have the will to live this life of Christ, if the fear of God is met by a healthy challenge, a serious challenge of the world, of, you know, evil, you will buckle. But fear of God keeps us, like Joseph, who said, I will not sleep with Potiphar's wife. I fear God. I can't do this wickedness against God. Fear of God will preserve our societies. It will preserve us. It will preserve our marriages, because we don't want to offend God. And that's why it's so crucial that we all have that healthy dose. And it will come by faith. Faith comes by hearing. Unfortunately, the type of faith that is being passed across is faith to get things, faith to make money, faith to make houses, faith to healing. And all of this is good, but they are really rudimentary. They're really tertiary stuff. The real faith is, first operation of faith is, give me faith that can help me fear God. Help me build my faith to the point that, you know, my fear for God will be so heightened as it was with Jesus Christ. This is real faith. Unfortunately, it's not the type of faith that is being circulated today. This faith is faith for healing, good. But, you know, you can be healed in your body, and if you don't fear God, the Bible says you go to hell forever. So it really doesn't matter. So the fear of God is the foundation of godliness. It's the foundation. And if you read Titus, the very first chapter, the very first three verses, that's what it says. It says the whole essence of the gospel is the gospel of godliness. It says the truth of God is a truth that leads us to godliness. That's never going to be possible if we don't have a training in nurturing in the fear of God. So the fear of God, the message of the fear of God must come back to the church again.
Well, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you very much.
I appreciate it. God bless you.
Thank you for having me. God bless you too.